And we're looking forward this hour to hearing Glenn Hitchcock speak on the subject, Hope in the Midst of Tragedy. Brother Glenn Hitchcock will introduce in just a few moments. Before we introduce him, we're going to ask Stacy Grant to lead us in a word of prayer. Stacy is one of the members there at Warner Robins. He is a 1994 graduate of the Memphis School of Preaching. He is a very good friend to me. We graduated together. I've always appreciated Stacy very much. I will not give him free rein just to say whatever he wants based on some of the things he's been saying up here, but I'm certainly glad to see Stacy, and I'm glad to be able to hear this hour Brother Hitchcock. We'll introduce him in just a moment.
Let us bow together. Blessed Father in heaven, we're thankful that you blessed us to see this day. And Lord, we're thankful that school has been blessed yet again to have this lectureship. We're thankful for all the men who are on it this year, and we're thankful for the theme, and we're thankful, Father, for the lesson we're about to hear. And dear Father, we're thankful for Brother Hitchcock and his dedication to thee and the ministry, and we thank thee, Lord, that he has accepted the challenge of being an elder in thy church. And Lord, we pray for him and those men with whom he work at Warner Robins, and we pray for elders, elderships throughout the breadth and length of our brotherhood that are sound in the faith. And Father, we are mindful that we are not immune to tragedy and challenges in our lives, and we know that this lesson is timely, and Father, we know more importantly that it's biblical in nature. We thank thee, O Father, for living in this great country, but more importantly, Father, we thank thee for our salvation in Christ. We thank thee, O dear God, that we share in this wonderful, blessed faith. And Father, this faith keeps us together, and it brought us together, dear Father, and it keeps us together. And Lord, we thank thee for the fellowship we will enjoy this week. We thank thee for the friends we don't get to see as often as we so desire. And we thank thee, O God, that we are in Christ. And we thank thee because of Christ. And at this time, we thank thee through Christ. Amen.
Brother Glenn Hitchcock is a 1982 graduate of the Memphis School of Preaching. He went on to do further work, getting his BA, doing graduate work as well. He's been preaching for over 35 years and currently works and serves as one of the elders at the Warner Robins Church of Christ. He and his wife, Mercedes, have one daughter, Lauren, and she is in school in Tifton, Georgia. Brother Hitchcock is a veteran. He served in the United States Air Force from 1972 to 1980. Currently, he's serving as an adjunct professor at the Georgia School of Preaching. He also works as a licensed social worker for the Dialysis Clinic Incorporated in Columbus, Georgia. He is one to whom I've looked up both physically but also as far as an example is concerned. Of course, I do that to a lot of people. But I've looked up to him very seriously as a great example for many years. And I look forward this time to hearing him speak to us.
Good morning. Good morning. I am so glad that my wife is with me today, because the lesson that I present today comes from her heart and my heart as well. I will not go into all of the stories of behind that. Those who know us know our story. But we're delighted to be able to stand before you. I won't finish all of the material that I have. It's in the book. But I will try to stick to it because of the amount of material that I want to try to put in to help folks who are hurting. When you have hurts, habits, and hang-ups, God has a solution for it. And I want you to know that we've seen and experienced that solution just by the very fact that we're in fellowship with those of you who are here today. You're my friends. You're our friends. And some of the things that we've gone through would not have been survivable without the body of Christ, of whom you are members, and you've touched our lives. And we hope in some small way through this lesson we can perhaps touch your life. I want to begin by saying to you that we're still at war. I invite you to think about Romans 10 and verse 10. The Bible says that the thief cometh not except but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. But I am come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. There are some processes that we go through as soldiers of Christ. Two of those processes I'll be talking about today, the process of dutifully following directions and damage control. What do we mean by that? Well, again, in John 10 and 10, the Bible teaches us that we have to first, as a faithful soldier of God, declare our dependence. My dependence is not on the thief. He wants to wreck my life. He wants to ruin my life through deception, through lies, and all of those things that would bring me down. Like you, I want the abundant life. And so I've signed my declaration of dependence upon the only one who can give me that abundant life. How about you? I've enlisted in the army of God as a soldier to declare my dependence and then to dutifully follow directions. In John 14 and verse 15, those who sign the declaration of dependence have no trouble in loving him by following his commands. And so I want to dutifully follow his directions. In this area of dutifully following his directions, this is why a lot of Christians who, because of a failure to be reminded of their declaration of dependence, falter and fall in the midst of tragedy and trauma in their lives. And I'll be punctuating that more in the lesson. And so with this ability, I also am going to don the armor of God. I put on the whole armor of God. Ephesians 6 talks about that, verses 10 through 17. Then I want to declare his cause that the whole world can know. That although life poses three great threats, guilt, grief, and the grave, when I declare his cause, he is the answer to the grave. He's the answer to guilt. And friends, we need to understand that. I think also damage control. You know, I can suffer a lot of hurt in life because of the trials that can come upon me as a child of God. And we need to expect that that will come. But when we hold to his unchanging hand because of our declaration of dependence, because we are following his directions, I can declare his good name to the whole world, even though it seems I'm in the midst of trauma, because this life in this zip code, this is not my final resting place. Let me remind you of that. We don't live for this zip code. We live for eternity. For me to live is Christ, and for me to die is what? Is gain. And so damage is control. I don't fear him who can destroy the body, but not the soul. I fear him who can destroy a body. And so as a soldier of Christ, sometimes we're going to become wounded. And God says, you know, I've got damage control for you. You know, you may be hurting now, but you come on, you know, in the days of the Vietnam War, you know, there was a certain place that all wounded soldiers wanted to find themselves in as soon as possible, in the hands of a medic or in the hands of someone who can take care of them, who can control the damage to their body. Here is a great physician that is poised to help me, a soldier of Christ who has been wounded either by trial, by trauma, or by the hurts of the old devil, or by a lesson that he's trying to teach me about that I have yet to understand. And when I can understand that this control is damaged, I can then delight in victory. And that's Romans chapter 8, verses 37 through 39. So when you put those together from the standpoint of the traumas and trials in my life, they come to us either because of the thief or because of the great teacher that's trying to teach us a lesson that we yet or that we fail to understand because we don't know who we are, whose we are. And so declare your dependence. That's your attitude. Dutifully follow directions, that's adherence. Don the armor, that's the attire. Declare his cause, that's the allegiance. Damage is controlled, that's the alleviation that comes from God. And delight in victory, the ultimate adulation. Now I want to turn to the text of my lesson. That was my introduction to the lesson. The greatest test of strength, and there I counted 15 major points to my lesson. And he told me I had 38 minutes, so you will have to buy the book. So some of this I'm going to read for time's sake, and I hope I don't bore you by this, but I want to punctuate some things that are very important. One of the greatest tests of our strength as individuals is the way in which we handle the trials of life. The way we react to tragedy and trauma and stress is indicative of the kind of people that we are. Recall the words of Solomon when he says, if thou faint in the day of adversity, thy strength is what? Is small, Proverbs 24 and verse 10. The people of God must not fear, but have faith in our God. We need to understand, and certainly we are not to fear the God of our faith. God is for us. He's not against us. We give attention in this study not to the proverbial why me question, but rather to the enlightenment of why am I not seeing that which I did not see before. What is it I'm not seeing in my trials, in my trauma? The matter is about biblical empowerment. And each of us, and each troubling circumstances that we go through in life, I believe very emphatically has purpose and meaning. Instead of expending effort on trying to escape tragedy, we seek to extract the meaningful message that may not be so obvious to us through the ongoing events of our lives. When one is receptive to the meaningful messages that tragedy and trauma brings in our lives, and will heed them, hope can be realized, and our environment, though shaken, is stabilized. Now here's the point. We must have a very genuine test of faith experience so that we can understand who we are and what our real purpose is in living to glorify God. Times of testing come not to uncover your ignorance or our ignorance, but to solidify the things that we have been taught, to bring full assurance of hope that the things we have learned are sound, steadfast, and secure. A very undeniable truth is that until our faith is tested, we fail to understand the magnitude or the magnificence of just what we believe. And friends, that is so important. With the thief trying to seduce us, we need to know not only who we believe, but what we believe. Unforeseen circumstances, tragedy, unexpected turn of events, misfortune, hardships, pain, and grief come into our very comfortable places, and we don't like that. Tragedy produces defining moments, and it is the unwanted principal player in the drama of my life. That's just something I just don't want. For the Christian, for the child of God, the question is not why do bad things happen to good people? The question rather is what happens to good people when bad things visit them? That is in your zip code, where you live. We're not talking about someone else. We're talking about where you live. One can be in the wilderness not because of the devil. One can be in the wilderness, not because the devil is even against you, but because God is for you. Since Jesus is the answer to guilt, grief, and the grave, Christians, and those are the good people of faith, they keep on being good because
The Bible teaches us we are to walk by faith and not by sight. There is a difference, by the way. When a person says, I don't see why God has put me through this. We walk by faith, not by sight. We can stop and preach on each one of these points, but I don't have that much time. A Christian's tragedy often solidifies their goodness, making them even more prepared for greater successes as we follow Christ. How is this possible? It is possible only when we walk by faith and not by human sight. In our deepest painful moments, we can continue to walk with confidence that propels us beyond our unbelievable hurts. How blessed are Christians who trust their declaration of dependence on Jesus. How our Lord is our ultimate and only hope who can lead Christians through tragedy. And again, for me to live, Philippians 1:21, is Christ, and for me to die is gain. I want to remind you of an example that I have in the book about this United Press release that took place in a Midwestern city of this hospital. They had all this shiny new fighting fire equipment all installed, and for about 38 years, they had depended upon this polish and this great little system they had set up. And there was a 4-inch pipe that led out from this system outside of the building, and there it ended. What was the problem? It wasn't connected to a water supply to give them the necessary ingredients that they need to put out a fire. And for all this length of time, they had trusted in that equipment. Friends, the lesson ought to be obvious. So many of us are disconnected from God in times of trauma, and when the fire is on, we don't know how to put it out because we have nothing to fight with. We've not declared our dependence totally on Christ. We've not dutifully followed his directions in the midst of trauma. We've not allowed ourselves to be connected. During this time of crisis, we discover how valid our faith is. It's not in times of peace and prosperity, but in times of crisis, we learn too many Christians have found themselves disconnected and independent from Jesus at critical moments. How sad that is to say. And I've known many of them. At one time, I knew that I was in that number. And I'm not saying that I've arrived, but I have signed my declaration of dependence. How about you? A relationship of genuine dependence on the Savior is required for success in the face of, listen to this, every tragedy. Can one be blessed in the midst of the storm of tragedy? For some, a blessing is as simple as assessing debits and credits. The sum total of all things owed versus all things owned. Yet to others, it is so intrinsic that it cannot be identified by possessions or things. Regardless of one's definition of blessings, they are available in the middle and in the midst of tragedy. Peace can still flow like a river. Peace can do that for us because in the midst of a fledgling storm, a Christian of all people ought to know about peace. Now you think about that for a moment. God has not called us to go to heaven on flowery beds of ease while others fought to win the prize and sailed through bloody seas. God expects us to go through that also. And as we go through that, we can still experience peace in the midst of a storm that's raging all around us. Why? To find out what we're about and to know who we are serving, that our true identity can be seen. Blessings tend to be more apparent in times of tragedy as opposed to times of triumph. You know that. Smooth times of abundance are times when one is least likely to make any changes, but let us never fail to recognize that sometimes an overwhelming breakdown may be required before one can experience an undeniable breakthrough. Our God can and often positions man in the midst of tragedy to bring out of us something that we didn't know we possessed. That something is recognition of our true identity. That's so important. You cannot be something by doing something, but rather who you are determines what you'll do. Understand this, that Paul did not say, I do what I do by the grace of God, but he did say, I am what I am by the grace of God. There is a difference. In 1 Corinthians 15:10, he says also, it is in him that we live and move and have our being, Acts 17:28. But what we are is not predicated by age. It's not predicated by race, political party, income level, parentage. Being and identity are not favored on zip codes, tax returns, or other externals. My identity, our identity, must be firmly established on who God says we are. Hello. When we know our identity, it won't be long until we, like Jesus, will walk through the door of hope. How is this possible? He arose from the tragedy of the tomb and a resurrected to power and glory. Romans 1 and verse 4, declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness. You remember that? There is hope in the midst of tragedy. It seems as though our Lord was being snuffed out before the world, but God declared his identity to the world. He's the Son of God, declared to be the Son of God with power and holiness by the resurrection. And to be a part of that body where he is the head gives me hope, friends. The Bible says in Acts 17 and verse 30 and 31, and in times of this ignorance, God winked at, but now have commanded all men everywhere to repent. Why? Because he have appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man. What man? Look at his identity. Not just any man, not the devil, but by Jesus Christ. By that man whom he have ordained, whereof he have given us assurance in all men, and that he have raised him from the dead. I've got hope. I'm connected. Anyway, I'm going to lose time. Where was I? Whew, this is good stuff, folks. Get the book. Let me give you an example of the prodigal son. In Luke 15, tragedy can be a very powerful shock to our sensibilities. In order for us to come to our sense of identification, sometimes God has to shock us into reality. Consider the example of the prodigal son enjoying his romp in the land of sin. He was without discipline or desire for correction until tragedy entered his world. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. Luke 15 and verse 14. Due to his hitting the proverbial bottom, the young man who was lost came to himself and was found. The prodigal came to himself with the peaceful understanding that in his father's house were what? Hired servants, and he could return home. Tragedy, my friends, caused the prodigal to humbly discover his identity before Jehovah God. Do you know who you are? His identity fostered hope. Hope gave him the resolve for an undeniable breakthrough to move away from the pig pen. How about that? Boy, that'd preach. To move away from the pig pen. He says, I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called that relationship, that identity. I'm no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. I who had identity before you, I'll take less. Just get me back to where I need to be. You know, it wasn't about him. It's about the one he was to serve. But it had to take a pig pen experience to get him to see his problem. A compassionate and loving father can oversee tragedy in the life of his children and affect a homecoming. And boy, did he have a homecoming, leaving the pig. What a blessing. What a blessing. And we think sometimes, we think the very opposite sometimes. Now I'm leaving this alone, I'm preaching now. When you get out here and pain and trauma gets in your way, the first thing you do is what? You run away from the church. That's the body of Christ. That's where the head is. That's where hope is. You're connected to hope there. Why do you go the other way? I don't understand that. Well, that's another lesson. I can leave it alone. Let's have the proper attitude to weather the storm, because we are equipped. You know, God built us with a storm in mind. I don't know if you know that or not. But when God built me, he built me with a storm in mind. And brother, the weather changes all the time, doesn't it? Somebody say amen on that. The weather changes all the time. But God built me with a storm. And let me tell you what we're talking about on here. The proper attitude to weather the storm of tragedy and crisis is an absolute essential. In the chaos and confusion of tragedy, one can believe that we are not the victims of arbitrary circumstances. Instead, we choose to believe our life has never left the hands of God, the potter who would fashion us at his will, at his own good pleasure and purpose, has a purpose for us. We have to let him do his thing. We are not in charge of what happens to us in life, but we are in charge of how to respond to it. Hello. How should Christians respond to tragedy? By holding to God's unchanging hand, we respond as conquerors rather than the conquered ones. And that's so important that we do that, because I think it's necessary that we don't see ourselves as being victims, but rather as victors. Because through Christ, I can do all things. And so we're not, we need to see this as Christians and not cheaters. A cheater is one, you know, you wear the name of Christ, but because you haven't fully documented your declaration of dependence on him, when trials come, you cheat by going over here to the other side. You know, as they say on one, I don't remember what show it was, we're going over to the dark side. That's kind of what some folks do. They leave the light of God's gospel in the church, and they go over to the dark side. Well, I need some Quaaludes, I need some pills and medicine for that. I have patients that I won't, you know, get into all that. But some of, you know, give me a pill, it'll fix it. They want instant gratification. And what they need is to understand their vocation and who they are, their identity. And so be a Christian. Don't be a cheater. Be a conqueror. Don't be conquered. Be a victor, not a victim. Only the faith that is challenged is a faith that is crowned. God's going to challenge our faith as Christians, not as cheaters. As victors, not as victims. Man, you're looking at me funny. Let me move on. You know, note the very comforting words of inspiration. In Romans chapter 8 and verse 35, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor powers nor things present nor things to come nor height nor depth nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Identification in God, because I'm on duty, dutifully following his directions, helps me to keep him at bay. So when damage control is required, I know that I've got a few licks and wounds here, but you know, I can move on. In taking the initial the initiative to rise to the occasion. Our resolve, therefore, is resolved. For only those who are pushed to the limits know the limits to which they can be pushed. Listen, exercise is a means whereby we are able to increase our strength and capacity for performance. The potter can employ various kinds of exercises, including the exercise of our hearts by the appearance of trauma and tragedy. The Bible says in James 1 and verse 2, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. Again, I say to you, only the faith that is challenged is the faith that is crowned. Teach us to observe and to take advantage of opportunities in life so that we can offset the damage that seems to come our way in life. In other words, teaching opportunities must be realized. The blessings of teaching opportunities often surface amid tragic situations. For the faithful, our Lord is not so much concerned with our comfort or comfort zones. Rather, he focuses on getting out of us the investments of talents that he expects out of us. God didn't call you to be a member of the Lord's church, sit around and do nothing. He seeks to bring out authenticity to our faith, to continue to declare his praises. Example of the Apostle Paul teaches us how one can transition from perilous and tragic obstacles into powerful teaching opportunities. The Bible says in Galatians 4 and verse 13, you know that because of physical infirmity, I preached the gospel to you at first. There's really no telling what might have been done had it been the case that Paul hadn't gotten sick on that occasion. But yet he also assures his brethren in Philippi that his imprisonment had opened several doors to the gospel. In Philippians 1 and verse 12, these things which happened unto me have fallen out rather into the furtherance of the gospel. You see, so in the midst of a seeming tragedy, the faith of the Apostle Paul was not about everything turning out okay, but it was about being okay no matter how things turned out. Are you okay regardless of how things turn out? Consider the record of Paul in Acts chapters 27 and 28. I don't have time to read all that, so I'll just kind of highlight it because I'm running out of time. He found himself on a boat ready to sail to Italy. He was not the captain or the first mate. His identity, just a lowly prisoner in chains. Isn't that something? He was doing the work that God called him to do. But at that moment in time, there certainly was no evidence of the blessings of a greater teaching opportunity. Out at sea, the ship encountered a storm and began to sink. Paul was inspired by God with these words of counsel that brought him to the very forefront in such a way that all who were on the boat knew and were now listening, not to the captain, not to the first mate, but to the prisoner in chains. Had there been no tragedy, he never would have recognized, nor his counsel would have been needed. But he was on the boat. And I want us to understand, we are like that many times. We find ourselves in these circumstances which our identity is being tested. And when it is tested like that, what do we do? What are we going to do? Paul, tragic obstacles became teaching opportunities. He taught those a lesson. You're not going to lose your life. And he wasn't the captain or the first mate. God can bring tragic situations into our lives so that we, to his glory, can take advantage of teaching opportunities. Stop focusing on yourself and focus on the Savior, and glorifying him is what's in mind. Provisions for tragedy. When Christians understand spiritual resilience, and because of the time, I will say there are 10 major elements to our spiritual resilience. Some of it is just noted in there, but let me give this to you before the lesson's over with. 10 major elements to spiritual resistance. First of all, what is spiritual resistance? Resilience. This is the spiritual strength to move through the internal and external tragedies of living for the Master. We understand our identity. We understand who's in charge of our lives. And our spiritual resilience teaches us that God has built each and every one of us with a storm in mind. May I give you these 10? It's not in the manuscript. And this will help us in our spiritual and psychological outlook as far as God is concerned. Got about 6 minutes? Oh, okay, 6 minutes. The first one is called partnership. That involves connectedness. As a child of God, I am connected to the head, but I'm also connected to my brothers and sisters in Christ. Connectedness to Christ gives me the partnership to know that I'm not going to cross Jordan alone. Number two, problems. Problems are about choices that I make, whether good or bad, and they result in consequences. God built me with a storm in mind, and as such, I can expect problems. God's word, when I dutifully follow his commands, will teach me to make the right choice in life and deal with the consequences, because he runs damage control, not Glenn Hitchcock. I love that. Number three, precepts. Understanding that as I go through this storm of life, I'm built with a storm in mind, God gave me the instructions. I follow his precepts. They command me to do this and to do that. When the devil comes after me, make sure you got your armor on. You never take it off, by the way. And by the way, it's not your armor, it's his armor. I wish I had time to talk about that one. But anyway, there's patience. That's number what, four? Patience. It's about control in the midst of a storm. Sometimes we want to run to Dan before we can think about it, when we need to slow down and let God lead us. We have to have patience. It's about controlling oneself. We control ourselves because of his commands, because of the precepts that I mentioned earlier. Then there's pardon. Understand that if I make the wrong choice, I can back up and ask God to forgive me, and I can have cleansing. Pardon is so important as I go through a storm. So many of us, and I deal with this a lot, we get upset, we get angry, we get emotional in the midst of tragedy, and we say things we don't really mean to one another, to our spouses, and even to the brethren. Well, you know, we need to know that as a child of God, we're connected to God, and as such, we have pardon. Number next is prayer. In the midst of a storm, you have to talk to God. Sometimes when you have nobody else to talk to, you talk to God. He'll get you through it. As they say, if he brought me to it, he can take me through it. But not if I'm not talking to him. God has ears to listen to those who are righteous. And then power, the power of God to effect change in the midst of a storm. Only God can do that. That's why I can't control the situation, but I can let God handle the situation. That's called trusting in the power of God. And then praise. When God affects a change, I need to celebrate, because from a standpoint of psychology, that's my catharsis. That's my cleansing. My catharsis is realizing that God can make this possible. And I'm going to sing that song of Zion. In the midst of persecution, you know, the brother just said a little while ago in the auditorium, I don't understand how Paul can be singing after he's been persecuted like that and all, because that's his catharsis, because that's his celebration, because he knows God is in charge and not himself. And then number next, purpose, our calling. Understanding that my purpose is to understand my identity and travel or traverse through this life knowing that I've been built with a storm in mind. I wish I could talk to you about the type that's very seldom preached on, the type called pilgrims. Pilgrims represent this so accurately in the book of 1 Peter. Pilgrims go about bearing good news regardless of what people try to do to them. Pilgrims go about trying to make sure you understand that it's not about us, it's about the one who sent us. And as such, they're able to demonstrate their purpose and calling so clear, that's why people look at them all funny, like, you know, you don't belong here. You know, you ever hear someone say, you know, when I first moved to Georgia, they say, you're not from around here, are you? I said, no, you sound funny. They say, well, you do too. You know, I went there, I said, girl, and they say, hey, girl, it's girl. I said, what? But anyway, understand your purpose and your calling. And also, I think the last one is providence. In the midst of change, in the midst of challenges, here's God's providence to provide you the things you need to complete your journey through the storm. That's completeness. I'm out of time, Mina.
You have another 30 seconds.
So, there are five lessons we can learn in the wilderness then. God can and often locates us in the wilderness, not for retribution, but for redemption. I love that. The wilderness is a place of refining and defining. Christians should traverse the wilderness as a rite of passage. They demonstrate this spiritual resilience. So you can be rejoicing when you encounter trials, knowing that the trying of your faith works patience. How is that possible? Spiritual resilience. Just gave you 10 points on it. The wilderness where a declaration of dependence is actualized in Jehovah God through Jesus Christ as well. And finally, number five, the wilderness comes so that you can ultimately do what God said you cannot do. You didn't think you can do it, but God said you can do it. I'm done. I'm out of time. Thank you, brother.
We appreciate that sermon. Preachers, never mind sermons that have sermons inside of sermons. That will probably turn into 20 lesson series before it's all said and done. We appreciate the work Brother Hitchcock put into that. Appreciate his delivery of it. Certainly is good to have each of you here. I'll remind you about the book room. I'll also remind you about lunch, which is being served. We certainly hope that if you have any questions, you will find somebody from the school, a teacher, a student. We'll be glad to help you out, give you any answers that you might need if you're looking for something or if you have any questions about the school. Let's have a word of prayer, and then we will be separated for lunch. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank Thee so much that we can look to Thee and can rely upon Thee during both the wonderful but also the terrible days of this life. We're mindful that Thou art always near. We pray that we will continue to be mindful of that. At this time, we want to thank Thee for the meal which has been provided. We pray that Thou wilt bless it to the nourishing of our bodies. So our prayer in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you, sir.